Welcome to Cutting Edge Web Content Development, the podcast where we delve into the world of CMS systems and their crucial role in website and web content development. In each episode, we'll explore the reasons why founders, CEOs, CTOs, and CMOs of web content development companies need CMS systems to thrive in the digital landscape. Get ready to uncover the secrets behind successful website management, content creation, and seamless user experiences. Here's your host, Jonathan Ames.
Welcome to Cutting Edge Web Content Development, a podcast by Butter CMS. Today, our guest is Phil Irvine, a transformational marketing executive with over two decades of success driving growth for D2C and omni-channel brands. Currently, he's the head of e-commerc and growth marketing at Mojo. Welcome, Phil.
Thank you for the warm introduction and thank you for having me here.
Yeah, really excited about this. You've had a great background. Tell me a little bit about some of the projects you work on and how you got into e-commerc.
Yeah, so I started out my career originally in technology. Not to date myself, but in the early 2000s, a big thing was ERP system implementations. And back then, the concept of .com and e-commerc was in the very early stages. I went to business school 15 years ago, and ironically, I'm now back in e-commerc, even though I went to business school to try to get into more of a general management type degree. But yeah, over time, I just fell into e-commerc. I love the convergence of how you can use technology, whether it's from a data media buying standpoint, with creative, and how you can really come to informed, personalized experience development with connecting directly to consumers. And we'll probably get into more later about the benefits of e-com versus other channels, but it really, with a lot of the work that I'm doing right now, it's working with organizations that have some type of marketplace or brick and mortar presence, but are trying to expand and grow e-com right now.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons why I was excited about this conversation is there are a lot of companies out there that are looking to put their toes in the water in D2C, but they may feel some trepidation around how to do that. And so when you came back with this topic of like, what are these steps to establish your identity if you're early stage D2C? Really interesting there. So how would you do that? What would be those foundational steps if you're starting out?
Yeah, I think if you're a brand starting out, you kind of hit it on the head, but really diving in and taking some time to think through what your brand identity is, especially a lot of the work that I do right now is in CPG and specifically beverages. I'm working with a couple of non-alcoholic spirits, and it's definitely a growing category, but there's definitely a couple of players that stand out because they've taken hard stance in what their identity is. And so, for instance, one of the brands that I'm working on, it's called Moon, or it's spelled M-X-X-N. In the non-alcoholic spirit space, you'll see tons of beer alternatives, vodka, gin, alternative seltzers. We really took a stance on having a higher price point, but that's also backed up by a higher quality product. And then on top of that, we took extra time to have really distinguished, unique design elements, not just our logo, but our lifestyle shots, our product shots, the backgrounds we use. And I think for a brand, thinking through how you want to position yourselves and the type of connection you want to make with your consumers is really imperative before you go out and just start spending dollars on ads to attract website traffic on Meta, Google, or whatever other platforms. I'll throw just another example. I worked for 2 years at the Books Company, which is a flower e-commerc delivery company. They came to the market around 2012, I want to say. And at that time, most people know about flowers because of Mother's Day and Valentine's Day. And the incumbents were 1-800-Flowers, FTD, Pro Flowers. They were these big behemoths. But Books was able to distinguish itself. They had, number one, they really doubled down with a concept called transparent pricing. So the price that you would see on their website was the price that you would pay when you would check out, as opposed to competitors would have all these upcharges, service fees, extra delivery fees, and things of that nature. The other thing is they had a lot of transparency that they put, that they displayed on their website and also in all their communications between the benefits to the actual growers of the flowers. A lot of their flowers were sourced from Colombia, which they were able to create a mystique of having better quality, but then also providing transparency into the benefits that we were providing to the flowers. So that's all to kind of say a lot of thought was put into that before jumping into the whole growth mode and perspective and really investing dollars in trying to drive revenue. Like once you have a clear value prop and a clear differentiation from your competitors is when you want to start to put your foot in the gas to get into growth mode.
So the first step is to really look at what's the competitive landscape. How are they positioning themselves? And then find that gap, that spot that you feel like you can own.
I'd say it's that. You know, a big part, I don't want to poo-poo. If you talk to a lot of brand marketers, market research, customer surveys, focus groups, there's all types of other secondary and third sources and whatnot, but also baking that in to understand like where a constant term we use a lot is what is the true white space opportunity? Because if you're trying to compete on value and price and you look the same as all your other competitors, what ends up happening is you end up competing on price and discounting, and a lot of brands just fall into the trap where they're constantly growing because of discounts. And so it's kind of a false growth or a false perception of what your true runway is. So yeah, I think investing that time to understand how you can differentiate yourself is crucial.
Yeah, no, those are some great stories. I think that for a lot of people, when they think e-commerce, they're just thinking, what are the products we're going to sell? What's the technology stack we're going to sell it on? How are we going to promote it? Not necessarily these ideas of like, well, what are the other competitors out there and what's my space and how am I going to own that? So how does that change from like if you are an established company and you already got some kind of brand identity there, maybe some customer data, where do you make that switch?
Yeah, I think not all brands are the same with this, but I think as you become more established and more mature of a brand, naturally your product portfolio or product set is going to increase as well too, to be able to satisfy the needs of additional consumers that you have as part of your customer set. So where my head goes is as you build up a larger customer set and you start to have more data, the starting point is their transactional history. So what are they buying from you? Are they high price point, low price point buyers? Are they, you know, if you're a clothing company, are they buying shoes versus shirts versus shorts? But I think over time, using that type of data coupled with website signals. So there's tons of technology out there. You can see what types of content customers and prospects are viewing on your site. And coupling all of that together, there's also some third-party data sources that you can merge with your customer base to enrich, to understand some of their demographics and stuff like that. But, you know, kind of coupling all of that to really try to make true either one-to-one or cohort-based connections where you can start to have a lot more relevancy towards what a customer is looking for you from a brand perspective, where the big thing is making a shift from not just pushing out what you can offer, but to understand what the needs of your customers are and having relevant interactions with them, as opposed to just one-way communications of just trying to push products and sales on customers. So, yeah.
So this kind of happens organically as you start getting data and you're selling more, you start getting a data set and an idea of what they want. How do you then transition? You said something really interesting there, making it not be a one-way communication, but getting interaction. How do you transition from just having data to getting some kind of interaction and building a strategy based on that for e-com?
Yeah. So I'll double-click a little bit into what I was just saying, which is more kind of from an outbound marketing perspective, but then the whole customer experience and inbound experience management is also crucial to get at that. But yeah, just to give you an idea, I used to work with a large entertainment company and they had fallen into a trap of the one-way communication. They had three unique product lines. Each product line had their own siloed marketing strategies and tactics. So they would have revenue targets, certain media budgets, and then would just put the foot in the gas and just try to meet those targets without any coordination with the other product lines. So even if a consumer may have already been a customer, they may still have been trying to engage with them to try to meet their revenue targets. So a big thing that you'll hear with brands is the concept of persona or cohort-based planning and marketing. So once you start to have more of this data and you can, if you can, augment your data set with demographic, family situation, and that type of information, you can design, the sweet spot is usually 4 to 5 different cohorts. And then as you go into either product launches or new seasons, having unique experiences that you use to engage with customers, as opposed to starting top down and saying, it's Halloween, let's just send this Halloween promotion to everybody, but having 4 or 5 unique types of strategies and tactics based off of your personas and cohorts. I think the other piece with, especially with e-com, that becomes critical once you get a little bit of scale is how you manage things like shipping, fulfillment, and then inbound customer inquiries. I think the marketing piece is obviously priority because you need to market and advertise to attract sales. But once you get into the mix of having to fulfill and deliver products on time, having data about your customers and having that historical transactional history and maybe insight into contacts where they've maybe given you positive reviews or negative reviews, and being able to proactively address those is also critical to develop these personalized experiences. And I'll give you one example. At the Books Company, we got to a spot where we actually had kind of a ranking system of all of our customers, and we had like 5 tiers based off of volume of spend that they had with the Books. And our highest tier, we called them VIPs. And so for the key events like Valentine's Day and Mother's Day, for flower companies, that makes up about 70% of revenue. So you're driving tons of orders, tons of calls and contacts of delays and deliveries just because of the volume of orders that you have to fulfill. A lot of times it's just a big pain. It kind of breaks the system. But because we were able to feed in our VIPs into our customer service contact software, We actually had a Shark Tank investor that invested in the business. And one of the other investors, one of her orders was at risk of delay with delivery. But because she was tagged as a VIP, we were able to prioritize the delivery of her order over a few others of maybe first-time customers or people that we didn't predict were going to be big value. And we were able to satisfy on-time delivery because we had her tagged in our customer service system. So just kind of one example of how you can think about using data to prioritize interactions or things from a fulfillment perspective, but hopefully that's helpful.
No, that's very helpful. I mean, I love that you gave a number to how many personas or cohorts you're going after, and that you talked about ways where you could interact with them, like in a review situation, there's a way to give feedback there. In a shipping situation, there's a way to prioritize. All of those ways are levers that don't necessarily always exist outside of e-commerce, but which are a great opportunity to have that kind of interaction rather than just we're talking to you. So when, let's say you've got your positioning down, or you're starting to get data, you're starting to have opportunities here to have interaction back and forth, how do you take that and optimize? I mean, how do you prioritize? Because there's a whole lot of things you can do in e-commerce. Do I improve this or that? How do you prioritize it once you're at that stage? You've already got those things in place.
Yeah, one thing with one of my brands, it's still a little more earlier stage. Actually, it's the Moon brand that I mentioned earlier. One thing that we're doing now or that we're building, it's a little bit to play catch up with our competitors, is we want to have a subscription offering. This also bore out of data that we've observed from our customers. We have, I'd say probably 10 to 20% of our customer base does order on a either monthly or bi-monthly or quarterly basis. So we said, why not put together at a minimum a subscribe and save or subscription offering to make it less work for people to routinely order from us. And so that's one thing, that one new digital product offering that bore out of just customer research. But on the point of these interactions with customers, we just now kind of came to a decision, but we were trying to figure out like what should be the frequency options that we provide to our customers for subscriptions. And we were going back and forth. We looked at some competitors, and there's a lot of different options out there, monthly, bi-monthly, quarterly, or weekly. And it was interesting. We didn't even think weekly would be feasible. Our bottles are 750 milliliters. I mean, I'm a consumer myself, but usually it takes me 2 to 3 months to go through one of our bottles, especially because it has THC. But we actually interacted with two of our best customers, and they actually said that if we had a bi-weekly, so every other week option to have a subscription, that they would take advantage of it. So we ended up using that intel to go to market with that as an option for our subscription product. So
you actually got in a conversation. You were able to talk with a couple of your top customers. Was that something intentional? Did it just kind of happen through maybe chance, or what was the idea behind that?
Yeah, I wish I could say we had some well thought out strategy for this, but it was honestly—
Sometimes it pops in your lap.
Yeah, so we use this platform, Zendesk. It's a popular customer service management. And we just had this one customer that either, you know, a fair amount of times they were inquiring about the status of their deliveries just because they were anxious to get the products. But then they also would just contact us directly to see how much they love the product. And this one customer in particular, I think she referenced in her note that she had placed 2 orders in the last month or so. So I kind of just said, why not ask her or let her into the fact that we are thinking about launching a subscription program and then what her preferences would be for frequencies. So yeah, this kind of naturally just came to be. But I think to your point though, having some type of effort put towards either focus groups or the other big thing too is surveys. Like there's ways you can construct really simple surveys, send out an email invite to your customers to get real-time feedback as well too. That's kind of the more academic way to get this type of intel. But I'm a big fan of if you can engage one-to-one with the customer, because a lot of times you can get a deeper level of insight and specificity into tactics. So.
Oh, especially for those brand evangelists, the ones who want every other week your product in their house delivered on a subscription. Yeah, you want to hear from those, because if you can keep them happy and find more of them, understand them well, that is kind of the 80-20 principle. Those people could be providing 80% of your profits, even though they're maybe a small percentage of your total customer base. Yeah, really interesting. So kudos to you for taking advantage of that communication tool that was already there in Zendesk and saying, now I'm going to reach out and ask some questions. Switching over from strategy to tactics, what would you say are some of the tactics that you would recommend? Somebody who's listening right now, maybe they already have got a D2C option out there, and so they're trying to figure out, how can I improve that? What are some things you found that work in engaging customers?
The real low-hanging fruit is making sure you have a basic set of lifecycle flows set up. So I think a lot of brands are great at driving traffic to their website. And honestly, if you just put a little bit of dollars in Meta and Google, the way their algorithms are set up, as long as you have pretty solid creative, you're clear with your proposition, the algorithms will find the right people to drive to your site. Granted, these costs are rising, so it's getting a little more expensive, but still there's that in place. But I think where a lot of low-hanging fruit that's not taken advantage of is, number one, with your website, making sure you have the basics of like a clear and easy path to take people once they get to your site to make a transaction, whether it's having a simple getting them to a product detail page where they can get educated about what the product is, what they're looking for, having clarity with that whole progression down the funnel on your site. But I think what a lot of people take for granted, where I think there could be a little more emphasis on, is the email series or lifecycle flows that you set up. So I have a couple brands that are doing this very well, a couple that aren't doing this well, but we collect a lot of leads, a lot of emails, but we're just not converting those people to their first purchases. But I think with the amount of website data that's available, you can use that to personalize, whether it's the products you recommend to them, whether it's the price points, and then also trying to collect information from them to know what they're looking for, and then using that to figure out how you want to communicate with them. I think that's one of the big things. And then even after they become customers, being a little more strategic about how often you communicate with people, again, what you're cross-promoting or personalizing. And then with things like subscriptions, identifying your best customers early and then using stuff like that as a hook to get them in a set it and forget it type mode.
I'm interested that you mentioned emails. A lot of rumblings out there that consumer email is dead, but you're obviously having success with some of your sequences. You're having like a drip sequence that's going out, that's engaging people. What do you think people could do to make sure they're improving their email so that they get this engagement across the life cycle?
There's playbooks out there. And for your audience, I'm happy if you want to contact me to chat through this. But I mean, the best way to think about it is, especially if you're working for a brand, like get in the shoes of yourself as a customer. What would you want to know about a brand before you purchase? Like if you're interested before you purchase, like do you need some more education about what the brand is, the best products, what your options are? And then when you're a customer, like what, you know, a big thing is thinking about not just cross-selling and cross-promoting, but how can you think about engagement with a customer that's going to make their experience with your product more valuable and more fruitful? Like how can you improve their usage of your either brand or service offering or experience so that they'll be wanting to transact with you again? And then I'm oversimplifying this. There's a lot of other scenarios and use cases, but then again, for your best customers, how do you want to think about treating them differently so that they feel extra special? So they're not going to defect and go with a competitor. Because once you get somebody to become a best customer, you want to keep them for life. So that's a real simple way I would think about it. There's like from a tactical perspective, there's tools like Klaviyo is the real popular email marketing tool because it integrates with Shopify. And Klaviyo is pretty solid. They actually have a lot of recommended lifecycle flows that you can just leverage their templates and then put your brand tone and imagery to put into market. So there's that. There's other things like you want to make sure your deliverability is solid. You have emails that are cleansed. Like some brands, they buy email lists or acquire them from other sources and they might be invalid or not likely to engage. So you want to be careful about stuff like that to make sure your emails reach inboxes. But yeah, I think those are some of the big important things to think about with email marketing.
No, that's what's important. Does any of this, you talked about treating your best customers differently. Does any of this involve like personalization, showing them different offers on the site based on their login? Or what are the ways you found that you can engage that best customer on site?
That's where we got to when I was at the Books and even when I was at Beachbody is we would have custom close funnel landing pages for certain customers. So yeah, we would differentiate the offering, but then also the product set that we would surface to them because we had so much data on what they preferred and what they liked. So with the Books and Flowers for our best customers, we were able to merchandise pages with specific arrangements that we knew they were more likely to transact with. So that's definitely where we're trying to get to with the brands I'm working on now. But it's also, I want to also mention a concept of surprise and delight. So a big thing we're trying to do right now is ramp up reviews for Moon and another brand I'm working on called Bear. And for customers that actually give us a positive review, we'll connect with them one-to-one and then provide them with a unique special offer, a discount or free shipping on their next purchase. In the future, we're also trying to expand this with our best customers on the surprise and delight perspective. We're looking into merchandise, so like hats, t-shirts, maybe like personalized shot glasses, and then using that either as a gift of purchase or even just sending it to them as a thanks for being a loyal customer. This is kind of getting into loyalty program territory where you have rewards for certain incentivized behaviors, but we're actually now starting to get into some surprise and delight activities. So,
no, that's amazing. I love that you want to do this one-to-one outreach to these top customers. Are you doing that through email or is that happening through some other source? Like, are you texting them or how do you initiate that one-to-one conversation once you identify that person?
Yeah, for this tactic specifically, it's email and then through Zendesk. You can actually manage all of this through Zendesk because we're a lot of times it's the customers that are contacting us that we engage with. One thing we haven't talked about, but we also do have some team members that are focused on increasing our influencer activity and outreach. So a big thing in our space is getting influencers who have big audience followings on Instagram, TikTok. Not more so them than Meta, but then trying to get them to push our product. And so a lot of times we'll just DM influencers that we want to connect with, and then use that as a channel for communication as well too. So.
Oh, that's a great idea. So is this like an affiliate way of doing it, or is it simply just direct outreach to these influencers?
Yeah, yeah. It's to date, it's been direct, but we actually are working with an affiliate. We also do affiliate activity with a partner called Catalyst. And yeah, they've been great. We have a presence on a variety of publishers, but we're also looking to use their platform to sign up affiliates. I think this show is signed up through our affiliate partner,
yes,
Catalyst.
You did.
And for orders that we can drive through a unique offer code, there's like a commission structure or commission payout. And so that's something that we're greatly excited about that we're looking to scale, because I think it just streamlines it and makes it a little more easier to incentivize influencers to participate and work with us in the future. So
yeah, absolutely. Any other last tips you give to people who are considering building out their first D2C site and they've heard you, they're starting to get excited? What kind of tips would you give them?
Yeah, we touched on establishing your brand identity. We really didn't hit on creative too much, but I think thinking through creative tone and messaging that aligns with your brand identity. You know, Moon, like I mentioned with Moon, we're planting our flag in this high value, higher cost player in the non-alcoholic spirit space. And we're also trying to have this cool, chic, trendy vibe with our creative. And you can kind of see that connection. So definitely would invest time there. I think the big thing that we haven't touched on that I would definitely put up there in importance is a focus on getting the right reporting and analytics in place early when you're establishing a D2C presence. And I'll call out a partner that we've worked with that's been great and very cost-effective called Databox.
And
it's a platform. There's others out there like Tableau, Domo, Looker is another one. But you can connect all of your data sources. So your e-commerce platform. So for a lot of people, that's Shopify, Google Analytics, if you're using that to track website activity, you can port in your email platform. And then the other big thing is all of your paid media advertising that you're doing. So you can connect with Meta, Google. There's a couple of programmatic platforms, but getting dashboards and data visualizations in place to understand what are trends with website traffic, conversion rate, like where is drop off in conversion happening on your site? What media channels are more effective than others? Where can you optimize spend, optimize creative? Like getting a big thing that we did that was a big benefit with Moo was we got all of that in place like within a month or two of when we launched. And it's just made it easier and a better use of our time to make decisions with optimizations now that we have a lot of these views put in place. So for the audience listening, if you haven't put time into that, I would get on that as early as possible so you truly understand how you're using your dollars for growth.
Yeah. Is that something, a data box, did they require a developer to kind of connect everything and set up your dashboards, or is that something you could do yourself?
Yeah. So the reason I call them out is that it's not required to have a developer skill set. Literally, you just need the login credentials for each of the platforms of where your digital ecosystem, and then it's a drag and drop user interface. There's some calculated metrics that you have to put together. So you kind of have to have an analytics minded person, but yeah, there's no development skill set required with that. So.
Nice. Shout out to Databox then. Well, tell me, where are the places that you find your inspiration when you're trying to get ideas and stay on top of what's going on in e-commerce?
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny. About a year and a half ago, I was in job search mode and trying to figure out my next move after I worked at a private equity company. And it's funny because I hated Slack, the communication tool. I had a little bit of PTSD from some clients that I worked with that weren't the friendliest. And a lot of the back and forth was through Slack and it wasn't that positive. But there's a couple of Slack groups that are really solid. One's called Efficient Growth. Another one is called Startup CPG. And I'm a part of a couple of others and happy to share with the audience later. But there's a couple of Slack groups like these where with these communities, they really are good and proactive about sharing the latest and greatest with trends in e-commerce, whether it's digital merchandising, paid media, trends, creative, pricing strategies, packaging, third-party fulfillment providers. Like, these have been really good resources for me to, I think your audience can probably tell by my personality. I'm a person that likes to interact and engage with people as opposed to reading research on the web or in a book or something. So I'm a big fan of these types of groups, and you can get a lot of great information there. So,
no, I really appreciate that. That's very helpful. I wouldn't have thought Slack groups. I'd only done that briefly for a while, and I didn't realize that there were other ones out there for e-commerce. So that's a good tip. If you were to go back in a time machine, see yourself at the very beginning of your career, what one piece of advice would you give yourself? Something you've learned now that you didn't know then?
I think with myself, I've always had a goal of being a general manager and having oversight over multiple areas, which is kind of what I'm doing right now. So I love the work that I'm doing right now. But I think when you're early on in your career, focusing on developing at least one area of focus or subject matter expertise actually goes a long way. And it actually helps you to translate what you've learned in that area to other facets of running a business. I think too early on in my career, I was trying to be a generalist where I didn't know what I didn't know about so many areas. But for instance, in my career, I got into a general management program with Experian. I wasn't that successful with it because I just had a lot of projects that I wasn't fond of. I moved to a different division of Experian, and I worked in email marketing for 2 years. It's not what I had envisioned, but that experience was truly valuable because I was able to understand email as a channel and then expand into all other digital channels, understanding the website, how the website connects with media, customer service. And so anyways, I would have given myself that advice earlier on in my career, like become an expert in one area and then kind of expand out.
No, that's great advice. Even if you want to be a generalist, get expertise in one area deep so that you can have that as something to fall back on and also be able to understand other areas. Because once you have that depth in one area, you can see how it connects to others. Like you said, customer service connected with email there. So it's all about how to get these interactions with people and make them better. So yeah, great example. So Phil, if people want to connect with you online, how can they reach out to you? Where can they find you and what are you up to there?
So on LinkedIn, I'm very responsive on LinkedIn. So Phil Irvine, pretty straightforward. You can find me there. But then also at mojopsg.com. Feel free to email me anytime. I'm very active and engaged there. As far as myself, I half my time, I'm the acting head of e-commerce for two spirits brands. But then the other 50% of my time, I manage a couple of engagements, but I'm looking to take on a couple of new projects, either as an advisor or as an operator. So I'm happy to interact and engage or brainstorm with anybody in the audience. So.
That's awesome. Thanks so much, Bill, for sharing all your experiences. There really is some great insights there. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. And thank you for having me here. This has been great.
Cutting Edge Web Content Development is brought to you by Butter CMS. To find out how you can build better with Butter, stop wasting dev time, and free your marketers from your legacy CMS, visit buttercms.com. Also, make sure to search for Cutting Edge Web Content Development in Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Google Podcasts, or anywhere else podcasts are found. Make sure to click subscribe so you don't miss any future episodes. On behalf of the team here at Butter CMS, thank you for listening.